You know, obviously we're here today to celebrate reading for these children. And this program, A Book Rich Environment, is called something that was begun a couple of years ago in conjunction not only with HUD but the Department of Education, the National Book Foundation, the Council on Urban Libraries, adult learning centers. All these things have been combined. And the reason is because a lot of studies have shown that if a young child is at their grade level in reading by the third grade, it has a tremendous impact on the trajectory of their lives. And also, you know, for me personally, you know, reading was such an important part of my life. You know, I was a horrible, horrible student in elementary school. And my mother, who worked as a domestic, cleaning people's houses, was also a spy. And she spied on the people's houses she was cleaning. And she said, these people are very successful. Why are they successful? Because they're not always looking at TV. They're always reading and planning and strategizing. So she came home and imposed that on me and my brother. We weren't very happy about it in the beginning. But, you know, very poor, but we learned very quickly that between the covers of those books, we could go anywhere, we could do anything, we could be anybody. And, you know, long story short, I became a brain surgeon, my brother became a rocket scientist. I think it was because our vision changed. Instead of listening to all the people around us who were always talking about what you can't do, we were able to get into the lives of explorers and scientists and doctors and astronauts and see what gave them the drive that they had and what kind of preparation it took. And it basically changed their whole world. And that's what we want for these children. Give them a view outside of their immediate surroundings and understand the potential, because if you can give a child that vision, they're going to be okay. The wisest man who ever lived, Solomon, said, without a vision, the people perish. Helen Keller said, I would rather be without sight than without vision. So it's all about giving our kids a vision, not of what they can't do, but of what they can do. And, you know, I celebrate what's been done by the group here, the way that they've been able to work together, you know, educational, as well as the city council, the mayor, the police, public housing authorities. These are the kinds of things that work in our society. And the reason they work is because we have people who care about other people. And I find that to be the case everywhere I go around this country. You know, the people, the most of the people in this country, they're not the ones you see on the 6:30 news who are all trying to kill each other. You know, they're wonderful people who are willing to reach out, who are willing to extend a helping hand. And that's the kind of thing that's going to make these kids successful. And with that, I'll open it up.
Mr. Secretary, can you talk about your larger vision for HUD and some of the reforms that you've proposed, including you know, work requirements for individuals, raising the rents for some of the lower income folks in terms of trying to move them out of the system and make them more self-sufficient. Some advocates for low income individuals have questioned some of these ideas and wondering if they are sensitive to the needs that these people have and the abilities that they have.
I appreciate you asking that question, because the system that we have in place now is not sustainable. So the option of just saying, just leave it alone, does not exist. So yes, we do have to look at rent reform. Now, most people in the news probably don't even know what most of our rent reform proposals are, because the only thing you ever hear about is they want to raise the rent on disabled people by 300%. What a bunch of crap. You know, basically what we're talking about is the minimum rent, which is $50 a month, and raising that to $150 a month so that people have, you know, some real skin in the game. $50 a month is not a whole lot of skin in the game. Plus, there are very few people who actually pay the minimum rent. So it's not like it's a large number of people. Elderly people and disabled people have been exempted altogether. So, you know, there's a lot of hysteria around that. The real meat of the rent reform is things like making the assessment of income every 3 years instead of every 1 year, so that people aren't discouraged from taking a raise. People aren't discouraged from bringing another income earner in or getting married, things like that. Those are the things that have kept people chronically in poverty. And those are the things that we want to get rid of. And you know, in 30 states, you can actually make more money by taking entitlements than you can working a minimum wage job. So a lot of people would say, so why would I want to work a minimum wage job? Well, just remember, when you work that minimum wage job, you gain skills, relationships, contacts, ability to climb the ladder, and in a few years you're in much better shape. That concept has been forgotten. People have forgotten about the whole concept of entry level and moving up the ladder. That's a very important part of what goes on in our nation.
Are you still moving forward with a proposal to raise the 30% to the 35% of people's income for public housing?
Well, you know, we have to do something. That's the start of the conversation. We have to begin the conversation with Congress. Obviously, we're going to be listening to everybody's proposals and working with them to come up with the right number. But what we do have to recognize is we have to be able to sustain these programs. And if we continue to accumulate debt at the rate that we're accumulating it right now, by the year 2048, every penny the government takes in will go to service the debt. There'll be no money for any programs. There'll be no money for the military. We will be broke. And that's assuming that interest rates remain low. So, you know, this is a serious issue. You know, I was talking to a congressman yesterday about it. And I said, why is it that you people in Congress aren't concerned about what's going to happen to us? And he said, well, this is one area where there is bipartisan agreement to kick it down the road. And that seems to be what we're doing. Somehow we have got to start thinking about how do we be both compassionate and fiscally responsible, or we're going to pay the price. Our children are going to pay the price. It's going to be a horrible price.
You've gotten a little bit of criticism for this $31,000 dining room set. I guess I wonder if you think that's fair. Some people would say that it just looks bad if the agency is spending this type of money and they're asking poor people to pay more in rent.
Well, first of all, that set was not purchased. It cost the taxpayer nothing. And we put in place financial controls to make sure that that can't happen, number one. Number two, people like to say a 31,000 dining room table was 17 pieces of furniture, and the price was according to the government specification because those were the people that they said you had to buy from. And thirdly, there probably is no one who cares less about furniture than I do. But, you know, it made for a juicy story to be able to say, they want to spend all this money on this dining room set, and they want, you know, what a bunch of crap, you know, but it's all crap.
Well, what about, you said, you know, kind of trying to save the national debt and stop some government spending. I mean, people would also look at this big tax bill that passed and the deficit spending that's happening in that and wonder, why are we deficit spending to cut taxes when, you know, we're going to be raising rent on poor people?
Well, I think that's something you need to be talking to your congressman about. You know, why is it that they load these bills with so much pork, with so many things, knowing that it's going to just keep raising the price? You know, the president agreed to it very reluctantly because he was so frightened about the condition of our military. You know, our Navy was smaller than it had been since 1970. You know, our Air Force, half the planes won't fly. You know, our Navy, I mean, it was just a disaster. And in an increasingly dangerous world, we can't have that. So, you know, he bit the bullet and signed it. He said he's never going to do it again, though. Because we had to get our military into appropriate shape. But, you know, we, the American people, are going to have to put pressure on Congress to control the spending. And all you have to do is look at the countries that have gone bankrupt lately. Look at the disaster that occurs there with everybody, We're not immune from that. We're going to have exactly the same thing. We have got to become responsible.
The last time you were in Sarasota, you were running for president. You were actually in downtown. You had a book signing downtown. People mobbed that book signing. There was hundreds of people there. What is it like running for president, running against Donald Trump, and working for Donald Trump and being in the government now?
Well, actually, you know, during the campaign, the president and I became a good friend. And, you know, philosophically, we're very similar. Personality-wise, we're very different. But, you know, he's very easy to work for. He just says, please fix this and let me know what you're doing. he has a very good understanding of the things that I talk about all the time. And that is, you know, we have got to get people out of poverty. We just can't keep doing the same stuff and being satisfied.
You talked about jobs, but a lot of the people in public housing already work. And we know that wages have not kept up with the rising housing costs. Are you afraid or concerned that by raising rent for people in public housing, you're going to push them into homelessness?
We are not going to push anybody into homelessness. We have exemptions for anybody who would find themselves in that situation. More importantly, what we're doing is emphasizing things like Section 3, which is a portion of the Fair Housing Act, which has been largely neglected for the last 50 years, which says if you're getting, you know, government support from HUD, you have an obligation to hire, train, or give contracts to the low-income people in that area. We want to take those people and we want to give them the training, the skills, the opportunities, so that they don't have to remain as low-income people. That is something that has not been done. And in the past, people have said, poor, poor, you little thing, you can't do anything, and we're just going to take care of you. We don't believe that. We believe that people have tremendous potential, but we have to make sure that they have the mechanism to exercise that potential.
One last question here.
So the event that's going on today, when you're out, well, first of all, what is it, why do you feel it's important to be out here and participating in this? And second of all, you're interacting with kids, and you know, we're talking about economics and stuff in here, they're disconnected from that. So what do you want them to get out of today?
Well, we had a group of kids in here before you came in here, and we talked to them about the potential of the human brain and how they themselves are doing the right thing by grasping those books and what that does. You know, you have to take those letters and make them into words, those words into sentences, those sentences, the concepts. You have to learn to use your imagination and the thing. You know, if you can get children believing in themselves and understanding what they're doing and understanding that there's a whole world out there, not just the neighborhood that they live in, and then they gain the vision. And when they get the vision, they're unstoppable. That's why I'm here.
Okay. That's all we have to-